You all didn't have the season that you wanted to have on last year. What improvements have you all made? Because you all were in a lot of the games that you played, but you know, it just didn't.
I think our biggest thing is that we gotta finish games. Though we go into a game, we start fast, we start good off, then we just fall off, fade off. So I think we have to be able to finish games when they count during the hard times.
And so with that being said, when you know the younger guys that are coming in now, the ones that are coming into the program, how are you teaching them or taking them under your wing to help them out?
I'm just trying to tell them. I'm trying to show them from day one how this is going to go, because I'm a senior now, so I know how the swag football go now. I'm trying to tell them, like, if you work hard, you know, stay focused and everything, everybody put together, we can be good.
And so, now with that being said, you know, you also got an in-state rival, you know, with them. And, you know, they are the champs. You know, what are you all going to do to knock them off this year?
We're going to go out there and we're going to just play football. They put their pants on, so we put our pants on. So I never been on to all that, the name, you know. It's just football at the end of the day. So we're going to go out there and play hard.
Now, Coach Dancy. Oh, first of all, Brian Bedford, he's Style Magazine. All right. So, you know, doing my research, I realized that your record that you all had last year isn't indicative of the team that you have. It isn't indicative of the games that you all played in and that you all competed in, you know. So how are you going to improve on that this year? Because, you know, even though the record says one thing, there was a lot of positives that you all had last year, right?
No doubt. I think we started doing that in December with recruiting. Bringing in the guys that we wanted to bring in, that we needed to bring in, that complemented what we wanted to do. And the number one thing is just wanting to be at Mississippi Valley, wanting to play at Mississippi Valley. That's the first thing. But it started with recruiting, going over into the spring. And I think that we're going to be much more talented than we were last year. We just got to cut out on a lot of mistakes. You know, I think being more consistent offensively with the turnovers, limiting the turnovers, defensively stopping the run. I think if we do that and put those two things together, I think we're going to win those games that we was in, because what we want to do is control the time of possession. And defensively, we have to do that by limiting the possessions of offense. And offensively, we have to do that by taking care of the ball first and foremost, but being able to have a great run attack like John Deere did coming in last year, not starting the first couple of games, but ended up finishing with close to 300-400 yards, 600 yards overall.
And so, with that being said, Coach, coming into the off season, how were you able to just have your players focus on getting rid of what happened on last season, and now, you know, bring them into the program saying, look, this is a fresh start, this is a new year, we can put that behind us?
I think they understand that. What people probably don't know, I've been with this young man here for 4 years. You know, started from a freshman. So his mindset has always been like mine. We want to win. You know, we want to be competitive and we want to win games. I think last year was my first year taking over, and I wanted to establish that mindset not only in these guys that have been with me, but the new guys that came in, that we're going to be tough, we're going to be physical, we're going to play hard-nosed football. And I think we did that for the most part of last year. Now we just got to put it all together and get these guys to buy in. And like I said, be more consistent offensively, limit the run game defensively, and I think we'll be okay.
Right. Now I'm going to ask you the same thing I asked Mr. Tompkins. You know, a couple of tables over, is that in-state rival.
No doubt.
Sitting at the top.
Exactly.
You know, what
type? Two of them.
look, if we talking real, right? But now seeing that, right, and being in your own state, like, do you look at that and be like,
people don't understand that those are the most important two games that we can play. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you, for one, because it helps us out in recruiting. You always want to win the in-state rivalry in recruiting. Mm-hmm. And if you can win those games, you have a better chance of bringing and getting the in-state rivals in recruiting. Number two, they're on the eastern side. Mm-hmm. So you have to beat those guys in order to compete for the trophy that we want at the end, the Eddie Robinson trophy that we want at the end. Mm-hmm. And third is just beating them. You know, I'm a Jackson State. I graduated from Jackson State. Nasty taste in my mouth. I want to beat them. Alcorn, I want to beat them. I've been wanting to beat them all my life because I've never been an Alconite.
Yeah.
So it's a great rivalry, though. Great in-state rivalry. It's been that way for a long time. And but you know, We just want to come out on top against those guys. And I just gave you the reason why I think that it's very important to win. And I think those games are so important to look at. I really do. You know, before I can even look at the other games, I'm looking at those two games, because if we win those two games, we know where we stand in our state. We know where we stand in our conference. And we know where we stand overall in competitiveness.
Yeah.
Because Alcorn has been at the top for the last 5 years.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jackson State is not too far behind. So we want to win those games, man. We want to dominate the state, the in-state rivalry games.
Yeah. I'm coming to you, Mr. Smith. I ain't forgot about you, all right? Because I got one more question for Coach.
Yes, sir.
Now, Coach, I cover the Houston Texans. And their first-round draft pick this year was Titus Howard.
Yes, sir.
And the stigma behind it, because I'm an HBCU grad too. I went to Prairie View, so
it's okay.
You say that's okay. Now listen, but hold on. I used to live in Mississippi.
Gotcha.
You know, down in Hazelhurst.
Oh man.
Yeah. So is Utica still in Mississippi?
Sure is. Hey, right on the other side of Jackson.
See, so you like, oh, he kind of know what he's talking about if he say Utica, right? And so, but there's a lot of There's a bad stigma and a bad stereotype behind talent coming out of HBCUs. They've already, you know, deemed this young man, you know, to failure because of, you know, the conference that he came from and because he came from HBCU. But there's a lot of talent in the SWAC, and you know, and sometimes, you know, there's circumstances that send some of the kids to the HBCUs.
Exactly.
But as of late, there's been a trend where these kids are starting to choose HBCUs on their own, you know, because of the rich tradition and the rich heritage. But Coach, there's a lot of talent in the SWAC, correct?
Yes, sir. And not only that, what these guys are doing and taking advantage of the opportunity to make these football teams in the NFL. If you look at over half of the guys that come out of the you know, HBCUs, when no matter if they go first or seventh round of free agent, they're gonna take advantage of the opportunity and having the time, those guys make the team.
Yeah.
So I think what scouts are starting to see is that sometimes we can be overjudgmental of those players and not just really taking a hard, in-depth look at those players, man, because I think these guys, we may not have the eye candy that the biggest conferences have, but I think we got the heart.
Yeah.
And nothing measures the size of a man's heart but the guy that's in it. But, you know, to say the least, man, I always thought this conference was great, man, ever since I was growing up. You know, you had the Walter Payton, all the Hall of Famers you see. I think we probably got more Hall of Famers in the SWAC than some of these bigger conferences put together. So,
yeah.
You know, man, I think it's going to eventually evolve back around where you're seeing a lot of these guys drafted.
Yeah.
But these guys have to put the work in and prove themselves too as well.
Yeah.
We have to prove ourselves a lot more than the guys that's coming from big institutions.
Yeah.
But I think they're up for the challenge because, like you said, they come from different situations, different homes, different environment that brings that out of them, that they want to be able to compete and play at the highest level so they can be able to take care of their family, their loved ones, and make their situations better. You understand what I'm saying? So I think it's a lot of talent in this conference. I think Titus is going to do great, you know, man. So
Quinn Bell out of Prairie View.
Defensive end out of Prairie View. I think all those guys are going to do great because one thing I think is an understatement in the SWAC is how hard you have to compete.
Yes.
You have to compete every day. And I'm not just talking about in the games. I'm talking about the way you practice. And I think that is starting to become a trend because I think we got a lot of great coaches in our conference who is instilling into these young men that you gotta start with practice.
Yeah.
Whatever you do, it start with practice. And I think that once we develop these guys and having great practice habits, it shows on the field.
Yeah.
And then later on in the show, you know, as they go on to play, you know,
on
the next level.
Mr. Smith, I'm sitting here asking myself, I got any more swag hours left? Because he motivated me. I feel like I need to put on some pads. I'm sitting here listening. I'm like, yo, I think I got like two downs in me as far as, you know, I play defensive end because I got a little girth on me now. You know, that's just a fancy way of saying fat. But, Mr. Smith, there's a lot of talented running backs in this conference. Are you going to set yourself apart from it?
Try my best to.
So what have you done in the off season, you know, to prepare yourself for that? Because have you looked at, you know, you've looked at some of those?
Yeah, I looked at them. I see how they look. They look nice, but you know, they're just an appearance. You know, you still got to put the work in and be what you want to be.
And so, and with that being said, and just like I talked to Coach, just like I talked to Mr. Tompkins, you know, last year, it was last year.
You know,
look at that record, don't look at that. You all were in a lot of the games. And being on the offensive side of the ball, you know, I know that there was things that you see, okay, that we're going to improve on. Did y'all work on that in the offseason?
Yes, sir. We had a good spring. We had a really good spring. You know, we trying to learn how to manage the clock, you know, take control of our situations, you know. Learn how to come from behind, even if the game is close, you know, you still down sometimes, or we was up sometimes. So we just got to learn how to come from behind, come together as a whole unit, you know, and win.
And that's the same thing Mr. Tompkins said, because Mr. Tompkins said that, you know, you all were in a lot of games, and just this year it's all about, you know, finishing. How do you instill that mindset into these younger guys coming in, and also get some of your veterans and say, hey, listen, this year we're gonna complete the task?
Yeah, we worked on it in the spring, you know, telling everybody. I mean, but talk is just, you know, talk. But we got to lead by example. So I believe doing that. You know, I go out every day and work hard. Do what I can, help my team, do what the coach asked me to do, you know, trying to show the young guy, if you do right, right gonna follow.
Yeah. Now, last question I got for you. Listening to Coach Dancing, right? You saying to yourself, man, you know, he does know how to talk outside of hollering at me, right?
Oh, yes. I always get that vibe from Coach, man. He's a cool guy, you know. I understand why he do what he do. I mean, it's a business at the end of the day.
Yeah, so. And also, you know, because just by listening to him, like I said, I was, you know, he got me, you know, motivated. Not to play no football, though, because my knees ain't going to allow that. I've been in the Army. My knees ain't going to allow me to play no football. But, you know, he seems like the kind of coach that not only is your coach, but as a father figure as well. So you all aren't just his players, but you all are like, you all are his kids as well, correct?
Yes, sir.
So he checks on you, makes sure that you're doing right.
Yes, sir.
And if y'all get out of line, he pulls you back
in,
right?
He stay on us about them grades. They're more important than football to him to graduate.
Now, how does that make you feel, though, as a player?
I mean, I got to do what I got to do to get up out of that, man. I mean, the NFL is only permanent to have a hand selected free.
Yeah.
So, you know. Yep. Life out of football.
Exactly. All right. Thank you, Mr. Smith. So you didn't think I had no questions for you? You're like, oh, he didn't ask them all. All right, Coach. Even though I know I've talked to you already, I still want to go back here. And it was some things that I didn't get a chance to ask you. And the first thing that I want to ask you is, how does it feel coming back home?
Feels great. Houston is home. I'm in the Third Ward community where I grew up at. I'm excited about being back home.
Yeah. And I've been asking all the other coaches this, so I want to get your opinion on it as well. So, you know, Titus Howard went first to the hometown team in Houston, Texas. But the stigma and the stereotype is there's no talent in the SWAC, and, you know, he may be outclassed. And I'm trying to make sure that I let everybody know that that's not the case. There's a lot of talent in the SWAC, correct?
There's a lot of talent in the SWAC. Those guys with the Houston Texans scouting department, they know talent. And kid deserved to go in the first round. He's really talented. There are a lot of other really talented players in the SWAC. And if you just go look at the Pro Football Hall of Fame, you'll see quite a few talented SWAC former players.
And that's what I try to tell them as well, you know, just watching them. I said, people don't realize that there are certain circumstances that send some of these kids sometimes to the HBCUs. Right. But, you know, within the last 3 to 4 years, kids have decided that they want to go to HBCUs. I've seen a lot of kids this year, 3- and 4-star recruits, that said, I want to go to a HBCU instead of going to one of these Power Five. And it isn't just because of, you know, they want an opportunity to play right off the bat. They just want an opportunity to represent an HBCU.
Right. You know, and those guys understand that if you're good, the NFL will find you. So being at an HBCU doesn't become a knock on you from a talent standpoint. If you go out and perform, and the NFL will find you, no matter if you're at an SEC or the SWAC.
Now, you had a good recruiting class coming in this year, Coach. How are you all going to take that talent, put it on the field, and have a better season this year?
You know, the first thing we talk to our guys about is being competitive. You know, going out and competing and competing from start to finish. The next thing we try to do is teach them about playing hard. You know, play hard and go as hard as you can. Don't worry about making mistakes. Just play at a certain level. And then finally, we want to clean up some things and play as perfectly as possible. We feel like if we do those things, then we'll have a better chance of winning more games.
And last question I have for you, Coach, is you coach at a D1 level already. When you're looking at where you came from and where you are now and watching those kids, there's really not that much difference, is it?
Not very much difference at all. And then from a football standpoint, football is football no matter what level you're at. It's about blocking, it's about tackling, it's about executing whatever it is your scheme is. So from a talent standpoint, we feel like we have enough talent to compete with the guys in our league. We're looking forward to going out and seeing what happens.
All right. Mr. Taylor, can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
You know who your first game of the season is this year?
Annual Labor Day Classic, August 31st, 5:30 p.m.
What is it going to feel like to get that first win, and especially against the in-state rival Prairie View Panthers?
It's going to feel great. Bring it back home, break that streak that they have against us.
Mm-hmm.
Send them back home crying.
Now, as a veteran on the team, how are you bringing in the young talent that's coming in and you know, the freshmen and some of the redshirt freshmen? How are you leading them?
Take it one step at a time, one game at a time. That's all it is. You know, they still have time. Time is essential. They still have time to learn from the basics and fundamentals of football. You know, me being a veteran compared to them, I have experience they don't. College football is a lot different than high school football. That's something they need to learn as they come in.
Now, how good does it feel to have a coach like Coach McKinney that's coming from, you know, the D1 programs and the A&Ms and Arizona, if I'm not mistaken, right, Coach? You know, and now having that type of a coach come back in, you know, and come home, as a matter of fact, you know, to coach you all.
Feels good. More knowledge comes with that. Teach us little things that matter, you know, playing this game. Getting our mindset right, competing at a higher level than what we previously did, and from there we'll go from there.
Now, there's a lot of competition in the SWAC, you know. Yes, over the last 2-3 years, you know, these teams are starting to get quicker, stronger, faster, you know, like I mentioned earlier, a lot of talent. What is it going to take for Texas Southern to knock off Alcorn State?
Be disciplined. As you heard, they had a lot of names called on these first team, all conference, second team, a lot of names.
Does that motivate you?
Yeah. You know, we only had two names with that. We have two on our team, one on offense, one on defense. I think we should get more. With more discipline, we focus on the little things, less mistakes.
Now, you got to tell me how to pronounce your last name.
It's Derigi.
Derigi?
Yeah.
Okay. Because the one thing that I always like to do, and I know that I'm probably old enough to be your father, but you all are still men, young men, so I always like to make sure that I call you. That's why I called you Mr. Taylor, you know, Coach McKinney and Mr. DeRiggie. So, Mr. DeRiggie, first thing that impressed you about Coach McKinney once he stepped through the door?
Just the way I carried himself and the way he's running the program now. It really impressed me.
Now, what are your expectations for not only yourself, but for the team coming in this year?
To play more as a unit, get better, and win more games.
And win SWAC, right?
Right.
Now I'm going to ask you the same question I asked Mr. Taylor. How good would it feel to get a win versus Prairie View, the very first game of the season, the Labor Day Classic, and the in-state rival?
It'd feel pretty good.
I got a chance to watch you and your brother play catch at Prairie View.
The guy.
When y'all came down there and destroyed us. And I'm saying to myself, like, this ain't fair. this just is not fair. But speaking of your brother, how proud are you that his number's being retired this year?
And I'll tell you what, I was telling the reporter earlier, man, and you know, I knew it was going to happen, but just didn't quite know when. But, you know, the family is very proud that the Tennessee Titans decided to retire that jersey number, man. And we are very excited. And my mom, she's very excited of going up to that event. And, you know, we're very humble about it, man. It's something that, you know, you always remember for the rest of your life. You know, and you know, I always kind of wish that, you know, he would be standing beside that jersey when they retired, you know. But unfortunately, you know, he won't be. But it'll be something we'll remember for the rest of our lives.
The whole family will be there. You all will be able to be
yes,
there
sir.
To stand in there. All right. So, like I said, tremendous talent. Tremendous talent. So, you've been with Alcorn now three seasons?
Well, as a head coach, four, yes.
Okay. And so, what was the mindset coming in? Because you turned that program completely around. You all have the best, one of the best offenses in the FCS, one of the best defenses in the FCS. What was the mindset of turning that program around?
You know, the biggest thing is getting a coaching staff that's loyal to you, for one, and getting them to work together and getting the players to understand the philosophy of what we're trying to do as a football program. And going out and being able to recruit quality players. A great character. And, you know, that's one thing that, as a coaching staff that we instill in our players. We're going to be great, but we're going to be smart. We're going to do everything the right way, do the little things right, and make sure that we dot our I's across the T's.
Yeah. What brought you back to Auburn?
You know, I always wanted to be a coach for Alcorn, even when I was watching Alcorn in Mississippi Valley in 1984. You know, and I always wanted to be a coach. And I figured that. Coaching Millsap for 4 years and giving an opportunity to get my feet wet, and when I got the call to come to Alcorn as an assistant coach, I was ecstatic, and just an opportunity for me to be able to coach again at my alma mater, you know, and, place I always want to be. And I'm very very excited about the opportunity that I've been given. So hopefully I can just continue to get this program higher and each year. So that's our ultimate goal.
Well, being SWAC Culture of the Year, does that put a lot of pressure on you coming into this season? Because you're SWAC champs and you're the SWAC Culture of the Year, and you came within 2 points of winning the bowl game. Even though I graduated from Prairie View, I was still rooting for you.
We sure appreciate it, man. And like I said, you know, SWAC is a good family, man. The Southwestern Athletic Club is a great family to be in. And I'm proud of this conference. I'm proud of the way it's growing. I think Dr. McCullum is going to do a great job as commissioner. Just that much, man. And we just got to continue to grow as coaches. And, you know, all the accolades and things like that is great, but at the same time, you still got to go out and work.
How were you able to keep your players you know, motivated and humble coming into the season, knowing the great season that you all had last year, and especially with this young man, you know, that sits to the right of him?
You know, I didn't have to do too much because these guys are ready to get to camp, man. They ready to get to summer school and start the off-season workouts, strength conditioning. And they was excited to get back on campus in June. And so that's one thing that these guys know about Coach Mack, man. We're going to come and we're going to work. So ain't just come and complain. Just put your work shoes on. Let's get to work. Let's grind.
Do you ever have to tell them about, you know, when you was there? Do you ever have to preach to them like, yo, when I was there, this is what we did?
I very seldom have to do that because it's all about those young men. It's not about me. So I always stress that. And definitely not about me because my time is up. You know, my playing day is over here. So I think I can try to instill in them, what can you do? How can we make you better? You know, that's one of the things that I always stress out the most to the coaches. And it's about the young men we got in front of them. You know, it's not about this coaching stuff. We got to make sure we prepare them to be successful.
And last question I got for you, Coach. Because I do cover the Houston Texans, Titus Howard got drafted in the first round to the Texans out of Alabama State, coming out of HBCU, coming out of SWAC. There's a lot, there's a stigma or a stereotype that there's no talent in the SWAC. How wrong are they?
They very wrong. There's a lot of talent in the SWAC, man. And like I said, if I had to do it all over again, I'd come right back to the SWAC. You know, and I love my HBCU school. And I love what we do. You know, it's a lot of talent that you missed out on. You know, because you're a Power 5 school, you don't have a lot of players drafted. But there's a lot of hidden talent that's been overlooked in this conference.
What do you think it'll be like?
That's what I said too, Coach. Just a lot of, because they don't understand some of the circumstances that bring these kids to these HBCUs. But I'm starting to see some three-star, four-star recruits are starting to choose HBCUs all around the country.
Yeah, I mean, we got a couple three-stars, one four-star kid ourselves. So I'm glad of that. I just wish that we could get more. You know, especially for the HBCU schools, I think that we have to extend ourselves and stretch ourselves far and beyond to get these caliber players.
Thank you, Coach. You know, can I talk to you quickly? All right. I got to do this, and I know that you ain't going to want to hear this and your coach ain't going to want to hear this, but I wrote this down. SWAC Offensive Player of the Year, SWAC Championship Offensive MVP, All-Conference, finalist for the Walter Payton Award for Best Player in the FCS. You was also up for an award for Best College Football Player in Mississippi, right? So I want to ask you the same thing I asked your coach. How do you improve on that coming into this year?
It's not going to be easy, but I work hard. So take care of my body, be able to stay durable throughout the season, constantly in the training room, constantly in the weight room, trying to better things, watching a lot of film, trying to get better each and every day. Trying to get better each and every day. Just, you know, helping my teammates get better, bettering each other, competing with each other each and every day. I feel like those are things that you do to get better. But you keep some of the stuff the same that you did last year. You don't try to switch up too much. You just stay within the system, stay within yourself, and that's how you get better.
Now, playing a quarterback position is a leadership position, right? Playing a quarterback position is a leadership position. Have you always been a quarterback growing up and had that leadership style within you?
I've always wanted to play quarterback, but, you know, I've always got knocked for the height stigma of being too short to play. I finally got my chance JV year at Little League. Played a little bit in high school, started as a junior in high school, senior year. Coach Matt gave me the opportunity to continue to play at the collegiate level. And it's been a true blessing to keep playing at this level.
Now, you are a dual threat quarterback. I watched you when you came to Prairie View, and I seen what you did. And it was kind of disheartening because it was on our homecoming. You know, y'all didn't have to do it.
We lost our homecoming too.
But watching you, you know, not only can you pass the ball, but you can also run effectively. And so for the scouts that are going to be looking at you this year, you know, to potentially draft you into the NFL, what would you tell them your strength would be?
I would tell them if you watch a lot of Russell Wilson, if you watch a lot of Kyler Murray, you'll see some of the same things in me. So, you know, just because I'm at a smaller conference, don't knock that, you know. Football is football at the end of the day. Work hard worker, leader in the weight room and in the classroom, on the field, off the field. So I try to, you know, watch a lot of Russell Wilson and see how his game improves each and every year. Try to install that into my game.
Now, as a team concept, how does it feel going from being the hunter to now being the hunted? Because now all these other teams that's in here right now are keep looking at this table because, you know, you all sit on the top now. Yeah. So how does that feel?
We accept the challenge. We know Coach Mack, he was telling us last year that teams are coming out to get y'all. So we accept the challenge. That just comes with working hard each and every day and being ready to go when those teams do come in to the home field and get ready to play us.
Now, last question I have for you. What, as a veteran, what are you telling the young guys this year that's coming in, you know, because you're going to leave a legacy. I mean, I just ran down your accolades. You're going to leave a legacy there. But what are you doing to instill into the younger guys that's coming in and keep that tradition going?
Hopefully the young guys can see that what hard work gets you, you know, because I was a freshman at 1.2. I remember being redshirted, being kind of down on myself. But hard work, you know, good comes to those who work hard. So one thing that those freshmen will be able to see is that hard work will get you to where you want to be and continue to win championships here at Alcorn and leave a legacy.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Yes, I appreciate that.
Yes, sir.
I'm Mike Wilbon. Same time tomorrow, Knuckleheads. You can get the podcast on the app or Apple Podcasts.
Big Sarge Sports shout out, world's oldest millennial.